A very good morning, kids.
In today's class, we'll be talking about the topic of ionic bonding. This topic is introduced in class 10th and continues in class 11th and 12th if you continue with sciences, that is chemistry as one of your subjects. Now, the ionic bond formation topic, it is a force of attraction which holds metals and non-metals together. Which means, whenever you have a metal and a non-metal together, the bonding which holds them together, the force of attraction which binds a metal to a non-metal is called as an ionic bond. Now, this also involves transfer of electrons. As the word says, ionic bonding. Ionic means ions need to be formed. If ions are to be formed, then either the electrons are to be lost or they can be gained. So, leads to ion formation. Since it requires ion formation, which also means either there is a gain of electron or there has to be a loss of electrons. Just to recall, if there is a gain of electron, the identity would become negative in charge, and such identities are also called as anions. Whereas, if there is a loss of electron, then the identity would become positive in charge and they are called as cations. So virtually, when you are talking about a bond formed between metals and non-metals, then it leads to the formation of anions and cations due to the transfer of electrons. Moving to the next important thing that we are aware of is that metals possess 1, 2 or 3 valence electrons, whereas non-metals possess 5, 6, 7 valence electrons. I am not taking 4 as a category because that's specific and we generally call them as metalloids. In this case, since the metals are having 1, 2 or 3 valence electrons, they would have a tendency to lose electrons. If they lose electrons, because they would become stable only after losing electrons, their shell would become complete if they lose the outermost electrons. So, to attain stability, they have a tendency to lose electrons. That is also a way how you define metals. They have a tendency to lose electrons. Talking about non-metals, non-metals already have 5, 6 or 7 electrons in their outermost shell. So, their tendency would be to gain electrons. By gaining electrons, they would complete their octet. Hence, since they have a tendency to gain electrons, they are called as non-metal. So, anything which has a tendency to gain electron is also called as a non-metal. Now, coming to the ionic bond formation, as we very well know, metals will have a tendency to lose electrons. Non-metals would have tendency to gain electrons. So, when I am talking about a metal, and if the metal can give electrons to the non-metal, this is the summary of your ionic bond formation. Ionic bond, there's another word given, is electrovalent bond, is the other name for ionic bond. Now, which also means if your metal transfers the electrons to the non-metal, it is clear that your metal will transform into a positive ion. Non-metal will become a negative ion because of the gain of electron. Let me elaborate it a little further. Metal ke andar protons equal to electrons hai. Non-metal ke andar bhi protons equal to electrons hai. So both of them are neutral. Par agar metal apne valence electrons ya koi bhi electrons for that matter agar chhodta hai, to now the protons will not be equal to electrons. In fact, your protons would be greater than electrons. If this happens, then in that case, it is clear that your metals will be positive. The reason being, protons are greater than electrons once it loses the electron. Similarly, coming to the non-metal, in case of a non-metal, protons were equal to the electrons. Once the ionic bond is formed, metal electron dega. Metal agar electron dega, to protons and electrons will no more be equal. In fact, electrons would now be more than protons. and if that happens, therefore will lead to a negative charge being more than the positive charge, because electrons are negative in charge, protons are positive in charge. We'll never talk about neutrons. Neutrons are neutral and they are deeply seated inside the nucleus, so we are not concerned with the neutrons because we are talking about chemical reactions which only involves electrons. So whenever you have an ionic bond formation, which is also called as the electrovalent bond formation, it would always lead to transfer of electrons from the metal to the non-metal, leading to positive ion of the metal, negative ion of the non-metal, and you very well know positive and negative, there would be an attraction. So you can define the ionic bond as the force of attraction which holds metals to the non-metals due to the transfer of electrons taking place always from the metal to the non-metal. So this was the theory part of the ionic bond. Now moving to the example to clarify it further, I'll be taking the first and the simplest example is that of sodium chloride. In my last video, I had explained about the Lewis dot structures. In this video, I'll be using those Lewis dot structures to explain the formation of sodium chloride, an ionic compound. We very well know sodium is the metal, while chlorine is the non-metal. After the compound is formed, we call them as sodium chloride. Sodium, and you have a chlorine on the other side. What is the atomic number for sodium? 11. What is the atomic number for chlorine? 17. Talking about the EC, K, L and N. Electrons in case of sodium are 2, 8 and 1. Similarly, talking about the electronic configuration of chlorine, you recite the electrons in the K shell, you have 2 electrons. L shell, you have 8 electrons. How many are you left with? How many? 7 more. So, you have 7. So, the valence electrons in this case are 1. Valence electrons in this case are 7. You very well know, by just by looking at it, it is pretty clear that sodium would have a tendency to give off its 1 electron to attain stability of complete shells. And chlorine requires 1 electron to attain stability. So this is exactly what is going to happen. You will have transfer of 1 electron from sodium to chlorine, which can be illustrated in 2 more ways. The first method, I'll be using the Lewis dot structure. This is your sodium, this is your chlorine. Sodium has just 1 valence electron, which is this. Chlorine has 7 valence electrons, which can be illustrated like this. Now coming to the bond formation. Sodium gives its electron to chlorine. If sodium gives its outermost shell electron to chlorine, what do you end up with? Sodium becomes positive, while chlorine already had 7 electrons of its own. It has 1 more electron of the sodium. So this becomes negative in charge. And this attraction between the positively charged sodium and negatively charged chlorine, charges can get cancelled and you can write it as NaCl. This is one way of illustrating bond formation. There's another way. In the other way, what we do is sodium minus 1 electron becomes Na plus. Chlorine plus 1 electron becomes Cl minus. And the attraction between the two leads to the formation of NaCl. So this is how you would represent the formation of an ionic compound if you are given an example for sodium chloride. I'll be taking a few more examples to get the concept clear. The second example that I'm taking is that of magnesium fluoride. Now, in this compound also, you very well know magnesium is the metal, fluorine is the non-metal. So the transfer of electron has to happen from magnesium to fluorine. Illustrating it further, the two elements that you have are magnesium, one, and the second one is fluorine. Magnesium has Z value equal to 12 atomic number, that is the number of protons and the electrons. Fluorine has the Z value equal to 9, that is the number of protons and electrons are 9. We are not concerned with the protons. I repeat once again, protons are inside the nucleus. You are not concerned with the nucleus. Your only concern is with the electrons, that too, the outermost shell of electrons, because these are the electrons which can participate in bonding, because they are farther away from the nucleus. So if at all you want to make them lose these electrons, it's easier to lose those. So only your concern has to be the valence electrons. Let me write down the electronic configuration for magnesium. KLM 2, 8, 2. While for this, KLM 2 and 7. There's nothing in the M shell. So your valence electrons in case of magnesium becomes 2. In case of fluorine becomes 7. Now, magnesium's Lewis dot structure would be this. While fluorine's Lewis dot structure is this. As you can see, fluorine requires one electron and magnesium needs to give 2. Fluorine cannot accept any more electrons. Fluorine ko keval 1 electron chahiye to make it 8. And that is what magnesium is going to give. But magnesium to satisfy nahi ho. Magnesium ko to 1 aur electron dena hai. To wo kisko de? It cannot give it to this particular fluorine because this fluorine is got complete octet. So magnesium looks for another fluorine, ek aur fluorine dhoond kar, usko apna ye dusra valence electron de dega. Which means you would end up in what? Your magnesium after the loss of 2 electrons becomes Mg+. While your fluorine, both the fluorines already had 7 electrons with them. And out of these 7 electrons, you have 1 electron each from magnesium. This is the electron from magnesium. This is the electron from magnesium after the transfer of electron. So you end up in a negative charge on this fluorine, a negative on this fluorine, which leads to nothing but Mg with 2 positive, 2 fluorines with negative, and that is your formula for magnesium fluoride. There's another way of representing the same. You can write it like this. Magnesium minus 2 electrons becomes Mg2+. Fluorine plus 1 electron becomes F-. There's another such fluorine which also gains 1 electron becomes 1-. So the net of this is there is just 1 magnesium and there are 2 fluorine atoms. We'll do one last example to clarify the last section. The next example that I'm taking is that of calcium sulfide. You will require calcium and sulfur. The Z value for calcium is 20. Z value is 16. Talking about the EC, KLM, K shell, L shell and M shell, the electrons are 2, 8, 8. You still require another shell because the electrons are 20 in number. You've only filled 18. So you require 2 more here. Coming to sulfur, you have 2, 8 and 6. So have a close look. The valence electrons are 2. The valence electrons are 6. So this is one of the ideal combinations. This requires 2 electrons. Calcium needs to give 2 electrons. So both the electrons are transferred to sulfur, leading to the formation of calcium sulfide. Let me illustrate it. Your Lewis dot structure for calcium would be this. And your Lewis dot structure for sulfur is going to be this. Now sulfur requires electrons. Both these electrons will be transferred from calcium to sulfur, leading to calcium losing 2 electrons, sulfur gaining 2 electrons, net charge would be 0. You end up in calcium sulfide. Or else you can write it as calcium minus 2 electrons, calcium 2+, sulfur plus 2 electrons, sulfur 2-, and that is it. My next class would be on properties of ionic compounds. If you liked it, you've understood the concept, it would be nice if you could share and subscribe my channel. Thanks a ton, kids. See you in the next class.